Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. What I want to do to begin with today is to give you a little bit of an overview of this course. That's going to be, I think, somewhat strange this semester because we're starting off fully remote and then we'll be transitioning back to blended in a couple of weeks. But I think a lot of the course is still going to be, you know, kind of the same, you know, because it is blended. But I will talk about what the differences are. First, let's look at kind of an overview of the course. So this, hopefully you can all see my screen. This is what our Blackboard shell looks like. And, you know, we've got tabs here for faculty information. That's where you can easily find my email address, my office phone number, my office location. So when we get back to being in person in a couple weeks, my in-person office hours are where I'm sitting in my office physically, and you can, you know, drop by at any point there. You don't have to arrange it ahead of time. You can just drop in and talk to me about things. And then I have online office hours, and it's somewhat similar there. The difference is with online office hours, I can't leave a meeting open with nobody in it because then it complains and it closes down. So for my online office hours, if you just want to drop in, that's fine. And then you just, you should see some sort of notification saying, oh, this meeting hasn't started yet. Do you want to notify the person? You click that, it'll send me an email, and I'll be like, oh, okay, there's somebody coming into my office hours, and I'll start the meeting, we can meet. Or you can email me ahead of time, and we can just arrange a time, and that works too. Okay. These office hours that I have are times that I have reserved for meeting with students. So you're students, you want to meet with me, these times work. I can meet outside of those times also. You just have to, you know, arrange it with me. So, you know, if you want to meet on a different day, get a question answered before the next office hour comes up, or maybe these times just don't work for you, you know, you're around your schedule, that's fine. You know, you just have to, you know, come and talk to me, send me an email, something like that, and we can arrange another time outside of those. Okay. I'm going to skip over. I'll come back to the syllabus. Course materials. For this class, you don't need to buy anything. You don't need to buy a textbook. You don't need to buy any sort of like special access thing. Here's our textbook. There's a PDF copy of it and a link to the online book. And, you know, if you click that, this just goes to our textbook. So, you know, you don't need to, you know, to pay for any access or anything. You just get it right here and you can see the textbook. If you want, you can download. This is a PDF of the entire textbook. Because it's a whole textbook, it's kind of big. But if you have like a laptop or something like that, and you want, you know, easy access where you don't have to rely on your internet connection or loading or anything like that to, you know, flip through, then you can do that also. When you go to the link to the online textbook, I think it also gives you options for, I think there's a Kindle version that you can download too. But anyway, let's go ahead and start talking about the syllabus here. Okay, so I'm not going to read this whole syllabus to you. What I want to do is just point out some of the important things. One of the main ones, in 2 weeks when we go back to being blended, you do have to come to class. So the lectures are going to be delivered online, but the attendance in class is not like, you know, an optional come if you feel like it. That's part of it. So, you know, make sure once we go back to being, you know, on campus that you are coming to class. And then, you know, as I already said, you don't have to buy anything for the textbook or for the homework. There's no online access that you have to pay for. There is online homework, but you don't have to pay for it. Okay, so we'll come back and look at that after we're looking at the syllabus. Okay. And then, you know, there's the various pieces of this class: attendance, worksheets, homework, quizzes, exams. The quizzes and exams, you know, the exams, hopefully we'll be back on campus. Those will be on paper in class, and we'll look at what those are going to look like, and we'll have study guides before we get to our first exam so that you can see what the exams look like. But otherwise, it should be pretty self-explanatory, and we'll take a look at homework here in a minute. Towards the end of the syllabus is a schedule. This schedule might change a little bit as we go. Okay, so think of this as being like a tentative schedule. It gives you an idea for where when things are. Things might shift a little bit here and there. My guess is not a lot, but you know, this isn't like a written in stone schedule that we're going to stick to no matter what. Okay, so for example, if we're going through something and something needs more explanation, then we might, you know, continue on and discuss that same topic in the next week and things like that. Okay, but otherwise it gives you a sense for what the whole class is going to look like, the topics we'll be covering, and so on. Okay. All right, the meat of the course is going to be under learning modules here. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. And this is going to be divided up by week. When we get back to being in person, within each week, there's also going to be things that you have to have done before Monday's class and things you have to have done before Wednesday's class. So it will be broken down a little bit further. For these first 2 weeks, though, we're just going to have kind of the whole week all at once. And the first thing that I want to make sure that you can do is make sure that you can interface with the online homework. So the first thing we have is a formatting quiz. And this should be really quick, but this is what the homeworks are going to look like. When you click on them, it should take you right into the homework. There's no separate login, no registration or anything like this. And this is just saying enter in square root of 5/2. And the idea is just to make sure that you understand how to type math into our homework system. And there's more than one way, you know, to go about doing this, right? So I can hit like square root 5, and then I can hit, you know, divided by, and that'll create a fraction, okay? Or I can hit this fraction button and, you know, put the 7 in the top and the 3 in the bottom. So it shouldn't be very difficult. You can play around with it a little bit, but make sure you go through this formatting quiz and it should not take very long. Okay. Then we get into stuff that you should know before taking calculus. This is prerequisite knowledge. And we're going to be doing some review, but for this preliminary quiz, what I want you to do, I'm thinking of this as being like a diagnostic, right? What we want to do is make sure that there are a few basics that we all know, you know, going forward, and that we're all refreshed on, right? So, you know, rewriting roots and powers, right, as a fractional exponent, okay? Foiling, right? Factoring. These are things that are going to be really important, you know, going forward, you know, solving a linear equation, solving a quadratic equation, okay, drawing the graph of a line. So these are just going to be some real basics that we want to make sure that we're fresh on. And if you get stuck on something like that, you know, please talk to me about it. I can give you some resources to look at. Or we could just meet and I can, you know, walk you through how to do some stuff. A lot of times what happens is you might forget something, but it comes back pretty quickly once you start going through it, right? So if you need a little bit of help, just, you know, feel free to reach out and we can go over some of these things together. Chapter 1, though, is also a review chapter. So this preliminary quiz is the stuff that we need to definitely have down right away. And then in Chapter 1, what we're going to do is we're going to go over things that you should have seen before, and we're going to go through them very quickly. So we're going to kind of rush through this entire chapter in 1 week. And that's intended that way because these are things that you've learned before. What we want to do with this is not think about it as like learning something new. Think about this as you just want to be, you know, refreshed. You want to be practiced at it, right? You don't want to walk in, you know, cold, doing a calculus problem that involves factoring, and you know, maybe you can't remember factoring, right? You want to say, oh, okay, I want to, you know, take a look at some of these things. So we talk about functions and classes of functions and graphing a little bit. Trig functions, which I feel like almost everybody needs some review of, right? Inverses and then exponentials and logs, which again, I think everyone can benefit from, you know, review of. So these are very directed topics. It's not like you're getting a review of all of pre-calculus and all of algebra that you know. These are just a few things that we're going to be using in the near term. And so the way that we go about stuff this first week is going to be is always a little bit different than how we go through the rest of the class, because it's a very broad view, right? We have a lot of topics that we talk about very briefly because you've seen them before. The way that it's organized, we have sort of a, you know, some learning objectives, a link to, some quick read, and then we have some videos. And, for the videos, they're each one is short and very directed. When you're watching a video with math, you don't want to treat it like watching a YouTube video or a TikTok video where you sit back and just kind of let it flow. When you're watching videos in a math class, you really should have a pencil and paper handy. Take notes as you're going. When they're doing examples, right? So here we have, working out an example of a function, right? Pause the video and try to work out the examples and then continue, okay? You want to be very active with how you're watching the videos. Otherwise, they're not going to be as beneficial as they really should be, and you might have difficulties later, okay? And then after you go through that, you can try the homework, right? You click on the homework. There are a couple things that I want to show you with the homework. First of all, if you're looking at a question and you get stuck on something, every homework question should have this message instructor button on it. And when you click on that, what it's going to do is it's going to generate an email to me that has the question that you're working on in it, so I can see what you're doing. And that makes it a lot easier to, answer your question. And then you can type a question like, how do I solve this? Or you can just say something like, I'm stuck, right? Or I don't know how to start this problem. That's fine, and I'll walk you through the beginning of that and reply. And if it's something that you just need a little bit of help on, an email is often sufficient. If it's something that's more complicated, or you're really confused, or maybe you're looking at the homework and none of the homework problems make sense, then instead of maybe going through with an email, it might be better for us to arrange for an online meeting where I can walk things through, a little bit more interactively and give you a little better explanation than you can get in an email. Okay. When you work on your homework, suppose I answer a question wrong. One of the things that you can do every time, every question should have this get similar question button, right? So I answered the question wrong the first time, but the idea of homework it's not an exam or a quiz, right? We're not trying to say, do you know everything ahead of time? It's to kind of work stuff out and figure things out. So if you get something wrong, you should always be able to hit this get a similar question button and it'll reload the question. And, for like this one, it's a true false, so it gives you a different question. Sometimes it'll just change the numbers around on you, but in some ways it sort of reloads. You have to work it through again, but you're given another chance. And then if I get the question right, I just have that point now. There's no penalty for not getting it right the first time. Okay. As long as you get it right, it's right and you're good to go. You can move on to another question. So these first couple are like true false, but a lot of them are not going to be, most of the questions that you do in this class are not going to be multiple choice. You're going to type something in, maybe a math expression, maybe it's a number answer. Okay. And a lot of questions are going to have some sort of other help on there besides message instructor. Like you might have a link to a video that will discuss this question. Okay. Sometimes there's, links to a textbook. Sometimes there's an example written out. So there's different question helps available. The message instructor is always there, though. Okay, so that's what homework looks like. So for week one, you're going to have a homework in each of these sections, right? Every section is going to have sort of its own folder where it has its stuff, its videos, and its homework, and you're going to have a homework for each section. Okay. For this first week, we're just going to have, our formatting and preliminary quiz. And going forward, we'll have quizzes over the material that you've already done. The homework is due on Monday. And the idea there is, I want you to do this homework this week, and I want you to start it early. But a lot of people have time to work over the weekend. And if you're working on your homework and it's Sunday night and you send me an email, I might not get to that email on Sunday night, right? You send me, you know, an email at 10 o'clock on, you know, I'm not get to it, but I will the next morning, right? So the idea is I want to give you an opportunity to get questions answered before the homework is due. So that's why the homework due dates are on Mondays. Please don't wait till Monday to start your homework. That's a really bad idea, okay? So the idea behind the homework being due on the following Monday is that gives you time to go back and look at things after you know, you've had an opportunity to ask questions. And we'll also do questions like in our in-class sessions, we'll go over some of the harder homework questions or, you know, questions that people have. And then you can go back and fix your homework afterwards. Okay, on that note, let's suppose I'm doing homework and maybe I got through the first four sections on Sunday. I had some questions on Monday. I asked those questions in class. I go back and I fix those, but I never got to section 1.5, or maybe I didn't have time for it, or maybe I forgot about it. And now it's Tuesday and 1.5 is due. Okay. You have something called a late pass. If you go and try it, and I can't show you now because the homework's not due yet, but if you click on a homework and it's past the due date, you are given the option to use what's called a late pass. And a late pass is just a one-day extension on your homework. Okay. And you start with 10 of them. So you don't need to ask me for an extension on the homework, you know, if you're just, you know, a day late or something like that, you use one of your late passes. Okay. So the idea of late passes, if you're just a little bit late, you need an extra day. Maybe you started all the homeworks, but you didn't have a chance to go back and finish them all. So now it's Tuesday and some of your homeworks are only at like 75% and you really want 100% of your homework. You can go back and use your late pass and you can, you know, finish the homeworks and get 100% on them. Okay. If it's a bigger deal, suppose you miss like a whole week or something like that. Okay. Then that's not a late pass situation anymore, right? You didn't do any of your homework for a whole week. That's a email me and talk to me. Okay. And you can always talk to me about homeworks and get behind or something like that, and you know, we can have that discussion. So that's another thing. The idea with the late passes is just like a quick and easy for small things. You don't have to worry about, you know, sending me an email. You can just, you know, click it and get it done right away and not have to worry about waiting for anything. All right. Any questions so far? All right, so this is a little bit of an overview of what the class is going to look like. What I want to do today is to go through maybe a little bit of review material. So let me pull that up really quickly. I can't find my worksheet. Okay, so let's go ahead and look at this first problem. We're asked to simplify. We're multiplying. The idea is that when we multiply like bases, we add the exponents. And so there's no other, like, just constant by itself. So the 3 stays a 3. There's no a's to combine the a squared with, so that just stays. And then when I take b and I multiply it by b to the power of 2a, I add the exponents. The first b doesn't have a power written, but anything, we could just think of it as having a power of 1. And I add the exponents, so 1 plus 2a. Okay, now these a's are both the same number, right, whatever number that is, but there's no way to combine them, so this is it. In the next expression, what we're doing is we have stuff raised to a power, raised to another power. The algebra rule we have to remember there is that when you take something to a power and you raise it to another power, that's when you multiply the powers together. Okay. Because these are multiplied pieces, each one of them can be squared individually. Okay. So for this first set of parentheses, I can think of this as 3 squared x squared squared y cubed squared. So 3 squared is 9. X squared squared, again, I multiply the exponents and I get x to the fourth. Y cubed squared, I multiply the exponents and I get y to the sixth. Okay. And then I repeat that process again, right? I'm going to square each one of these three factors separately. So 9 squared is 81. X to the fourth squared, I multiply the power, so I get x to the eighth. And then y to the sixth, which is then squared, I multiply the exponents, and I'll get y to the 12th. Okay, so I'll give you a minute. Try problems 3 and 4. That's going to be basically the same stuff. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look at problem 3. Here I have y to the 3n minus 5 raised to the 4th power. And we're using the same rule that we did back here in problem 2. I have a power raised to another power, so I multiply the exponents. The difference here is that my exponent isn't just one number. It's this expression. So I'm going to take 3n minus 5 and multiply it by 4. And so then I can distribute that 4. So I'm going to have y to the 12n minus 20. Okay. So it's the same rule, but different feel to it here. On problem 4, I'm doing, again, that same rule. I have a power raised to another power. This time my power is a little bit more complicated, but we just follow the same procedure. We're going to take n, and we're going to multiply it by 3n. So now this time, n times 3n, if I ignore the fact this is inside an exponent, n times 3n I know is going to be 3n squared. So my exponent is 3n squared. Okay. So my result is a little bit more complicated looking. I have, you know, a power to a power, but that's all right. Okay. So let's go ahead and try problems 5 and 6 now. 5 and 6 aren't going to be different rules, but they are more complicated. There's a lot of pieces in there. So let's go ahead and simplify this as much as you can. There's also division there, and I know that, you know, when I multiply like bases, I add. When we divide like bases, we subtract the exponents. So I'll give you a minute to go ahead and try this one out. Let's go through number 5. I'm going to go through this a little bit more deliberately than the last couple, because there's a lot of pieces in here. We have everything is base E, okay, which hopefully we've all seen before. But the main thing is that it's a common base, so that makes it easy. So let's start inside the parentheses. I have all of these E's. When I multiply, we're going to add the exponents, and when I divide, I'm going to subtract. So I can write this as e to the 3x squared plus 4x minus 5x. Right. So now I can simplify the exponent. Right? 4x minus 5x will give me a negative x. Okay. Now I have an expression that's cubed. Because it's just one thing to a power, that makes it easier, right? I can say, all right, when I take a power raised to a power, I multiply the powers. So I'm going to have e, and I'm going to take this first power, 3x squared minus x, and I'm going to multiply it by the second power of the 3. So I distribute the multiplication. And we'll have 9x squared minus 3x as our new exponent. Okay, now we have this e to the 2t up front. Now I'm doing that first thing that we were, first rule we were looking at. When I multiply like bases, we add the exponents. So we're going to have e to the 2t plus 9x squared minus 3x. And they're different variables, so they don't combine together at all. So that's it. Okay, number six is going to work very similarly. It's you know, all of the same rules, just a different example. So we'll go through that right now. The e to the negative 2t is going to hang out for a little while because I want to work inside the parentheses to begin with. So I'm going to do this all as one step. The multiplying, I'm going to add the exponents. For the division, I'm going to subtract that exponent. So we have e to the x squared minus 3, and then I'm going to add 5, and then I'm going to subtract 9x plus 1. I want to subtract all of 9x plus 1, though, not just the 9x. So I'm going to put the 9x plus 1 in parentheses. And what I could do then is say, okay, to get rid of the parentheses, I distribute the negative. So it's like a negative 9x and a negative 1. Okay, so simplifying our exponent here, we have the x squared. I have negative 3 plus 5 minus 1. So negative 3 plus 5 is 2, and minus 1 is 1. And then we have minus 9x. Okay, this exponential is raised to the fifth, so I'm going to multiply the exponents. So we have e to the 5x squared plus 5 minus 45x. And now in my last step, I'm multiplying like bases again. I'm going to add the exponents. So I have e to the negative 2t plus 5x squared plus 5 minus 45x. Okay. All right, that's simplifying exponentials. Now let's look at solving equations. What I'm doing here is kind of giving you a little bit of an overview. We're going to be going through this, this whole process in pieces in the chapter, but I want to highlight some of the things that I think are, you know, the easiest areas to forget, and solving equations can be the trickiest. Okay. When we solve equations that involve weird functions like exponentials and logs and trig functions, what we typically want to do is get the x out of that tricky function. And the way that we do that is using its inverse. So if I have an exponential base 2, then the way that I can get rid of it is with a log base 2. That's its inverse. So I can think of taking the log base 2 of both sides. Okay, now here's something that I want to point out. We are not multiplying by log. Okay, to give you a little bit of an analogy, if I had x squared equals 9, I don't multiply both sides by the square root function. We don't say x squared times square root equals square root of 9. That doesn't make any sense at all. Okay, it's the same thing with other functions, right? We don't multiply by, that log base 2. We plug into the log base 2. Just like we don't multiply by the square root function, we plug into it. We don't multiply by sine, we plug into the sine function, right? So, so this is not multiplication here. But what it does do for us is a log and an exponential with the same base wipe each other out, and we just get x equals. Okay, so I can write y equals log base 2 of 10. And that's it. That gives me a nice exact answer. Okay. Over here I have a log, and I can get rid of this using an exponential, right? This is a log base 6, so I'm going to get rid of it with an exponential base 6. So I'm going to take 6 to the power of both sides. So 6 to the log base 6 of x just gives me x, so x equals 6 squared. Okay, so we'll go through this in more detail in the section on inverses, but the key thing that I wanted to point out here is that when we're working with inverses, we don't multiply by the inverse. We're plugging into it. It's composition, not multiplication. Okay, so let's get to some that are a little bit more familiar. So problem 9 here, you know, I've got a bunch of square roots and exponents and stuff like that, and that should look like stuff that we've worked on before. So go ahead and try that one. Try 9 and 10. 10, you know, has the log in there, so you kind of have to do that same process that we did a minute ago. But I'll give you a minute to try these two out, and then we'll go through them together. All right, to solve problem 9, before we start like solving the equation, what we want to do is to rewrite these expressions in a more friendly format. Okay, so for example, if I have a root, in this case it's a cube root, but I also have all these other like powers, it's handy to write the roots as an exponent. Okay, so just as a little bit of a refresher, when we write the square root, I can write that as a half power. If I have the cube root, I write that as a 1/3 power. Okay. And just as a reminder, when you have stuff in the denominator, that's not going to come up in this problem, but that's where we get a negative exponent. Okay, so if I had something like 1 over n cubed, I could write that as n to the negative 3. All right, so let's go ahead and look at this problem now. So here we have the cube root of 2, so I can write this as 2 to the 1/3. And that is then raised to the power of 2 minus x. The right-hand side, we're not going to do anything to right now. Earlier, what we were doing is we were saying, okay, if I have a base raised to a power, raised to another power, I multiply the powers together. So I'm going to have 2 to the 1/3 times 2 minus x. Okay. And what we're going to do here is look at this and say I have 2 to a power equal to 2 to a power. The only way that that can happen is if the powers are the same. Okay. So the only way that these two things can be equal are if 1/3 times 2 minus x is equal to x squared. So it's not like I divided both sides by 2 or anything like that. One way to do this is just to say, I'm just equating the exponents to each other. You could also say take the log base 2 of both sides, but I think just saying we're going to now look at the exponents, right, because the bases are the same, and solve that equation, that's a good way of doing things. Okay. In this equation, I have a 1/3 in here. You could distribute 1/3, and that's perfectly fine, but I don't really like to have fractions floating around in my problem. So rather than distribute the 1/3, what I'm going to do is multiply both sides by 3. And that way, 3 times a third cancels, and I don't have any fractions in here. So we just have 2 minus x equals 3x squared. Now, to solve this, I have to look at this and recognize, oh, I have an x squared. This is a quadratic. I want to solve it like it's a quadratic. Okay. The way that we solve quadratics are to get everything on one side. So I'm going to add x to both sides and subtract 2 from both sides. Okay. So I'm going to have 0 equals 3x squared plus x minus 2. And then from here, I have two choices. I can either factor, if I see how it factors, okay, or if it does factor, or I can use the quadratic formula. Now, because it has a 3 in front of the x squared, some of you may not either remember or might not be, you know, practiced or comfortable with factoring quadratics that don't have a 1 in front. And if that's the case, if you're like, this is going to be slow and difficult, well, then just jump straight to the quadratic formula. If you look at this and say, like, oh, I don't have a problem with that, I can factor this right away, you know, then that's the fastest way to solve it. Okay. But just to, I think, maybe be useful here, I'm going to go ahead and solve this using the quadratic formula. So let's go ahead and write down the quadratic formula. So the quadratic formula, if I have ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0, then the solutions are x equals the opposite of b plus or minus, you know, it gives me two options, so two answers, the square root of b squared minus 4ac, and all of that is over 2a. In this case, my a is 3, my b is 1, and my c is negative 2. So when I write down my solutions here, the x is the opposite of 1, so negative 1 plus or minus the square root of b squared, so negative 1, or sorry, positive 1 squared, minus 4 times 3 times negative 2, all over 2 times 3. Now we'll simplify this down a little bit. 1 squared is 1. Minus a negative is plus. 4 times 3 is 12. Times 2 is 24. 2 times 3 is 6. Okay. And continuing along, 1 plus 24 is 25, and the square root of 25 is 5. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to break this up into 2. I'm going to write x equals negative 1 plus 5 over 6. Simplify that. 5 minus 1 is 4. So we have 4/6, which is 2/3, okay? Or when I have a subtraction, negative 1 minus 5 is negative 6. So negative 6 over 6 is negative 1. Okay, so that gives me my solutions there. And yeah, if you factor it, it's going to go faster. Okay, unless you don't remember how to factor. All right, let's try problem 10. Here we have a log base 2, and the x is somewhere inside of that. What we could do to start with is get rid of the log using an exponential, right? So the idea when I'm solving for x is to peel away all the things that are around the x. So I'm going to start on the outside and take 2 to the power of both sides. So I'm going to think of both sides as being exponents of a base of 2. Okay, so we have 2 to the log base 2 of 8x equals 2 to the negative 3. And on the left-hand side, I have an exponential and a log with the same base, so they cancel each other out. So we have 8 to the power of x. And on the right-hand side, we have 2 to the power of negative 3. Now, the way that I'm going to solve from here, right, you could rewrite 2 to the negative 3, right, as a fraction and compute away. But then on this left-hand side, in order to get rid of the 8, I feel like I would need to take a logarithm of both sides. And what might be a little bit easier is to say, well, I can rewrite 8 as a power of 2, because I already have the right-hand side as a power of 2. 8 is 2 to the third. So this is 2 to the third to the x. Okay. Or I could write that as 2 to the 3x. And now I have 2 to the 3x equals 2 to the negative 3. I'm going to do the same thing that we did back, in this last problem. If I have, 2 to a power equals 2 to a different power, then those really must be the same power. 3x must be equal to negative 3. So then I can solve that by dividing by 3, and I get that x is negative 1. Okay. So let's go ahead and try problems 11 and 12. I'll give you a second to go ahead and work those out. Maybe just as a reminder, some of our properties of logs. If I have log base b of x plus log base b of y, I can rewrite that as log base b of x times y. Okay. With exponentials, when we multiply on the outside of the exponential, that turns into adding the powers. So it's adding on the inside. Here, it's the opposite with logs. When I add on the outside, it turns into multiplication on the inside. Okay. Same thing with division and subtraction, right? I subtract on the outside, that turns into division on the inside. Okay, and if we take an exponent, I don't think that'll come up in this problem. Well, it might. If I take log base b of x to the power of y, right, we can bring that y down out front, right? Y times log base b of x, and that goes both directions. Okay, so those are some properties of logs that you've all learned before that you might need to use on these next two problems. I'll give you another minute, see if you can work through these, and then we'll go over them together. Let's go ahead and take a look at problem 11 now. Problem 11, the idea here was to write down something ridiculously complicated so that we can see how to use all of our log rules. This isn't a problem that I'm going to give you like on a test or something like that. And it's not something that we'll likely be seeing. This is going to be more complicated than the stuff we'll be working with. The goal here is just to kind of like really stretch the limits of all of the rules and try to shove everything into one problem. And hopefully by doing so, we can say, all right, the stuff that we'll actually be seeing and using is going to be less complicated and we'll be better prepared for that. So let's go ahead and take a look. The first thing that makes this a really difficult problem is that the logarithms have different bases. One of them is base 9 and the other one is base 3. And that can be challenging. The thing that we have going for us is that 9 is a power of 3. And, exponentials and logs, they go together nicely. So if one of these is a power of the other, then I think that we can actually make some progress. Okay. One of the mistakes that I want to point out is that if we were just to do something like, okay, in the earlier problems, we said, oh, I can get rid of a logarithm by using an exponential, like here, right? We have a log base 6, so take 6 to the power of both sides. We have to be careful. You take that power to both sides, all of both sides. So if I can't just say, all right, take 9 to the power of this guy, 9 to the power of this guy, 9 to the power of this guy. We have to be careful about the addition here. All right. And we also have to be careful about this 3 out front. So there's a lot of things going on sort of all at once. So let's just take care of this one piece at a time. First of all, this 3, I'm going to use this rule down here sort of backwards. I'm going to think of this 3 out front, and I can move it up as an exponent. So we can write this as the log base 9 of x plus the log base 3 of x to the third. Now, I would like to use my log rules that say when you're adding things together, I can just multiply on the inside to combine these two. But it doesn't work because they're not the same base. We say, all right, we'll just throw that right out. So what I'm going to do then is I'm going to say, well, I'm going to try and get rid of these logarithms using an exponential. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, all right, this first one is a base of 9, so we'll just start with 9. I'm going to take 9 to the power of the left equals 9 to the power of the right. And I know with exponentials, if I had 9 to the a plus b, I could write that as 9 to the a times 9 to the b. Right? When you're adding your exponents, you can break that up into multiplying on the outside. Typically, we go the other direction when we're simplifying, but I'm going to use my rule backwards here. So I'm going to write this as 9 to the power of log base 9 of x times 9 to the power of log base 3 of x cubed. And on the right-hand side, I just have 9 to the 14th. I'm going to leave this as 9 to the 14th because taking 9 to the 14th power is going to be some big number, and I don't want to write out that big crazy number all the time. So we're just going to leave that as 9 to the 14th. Okay. This first piece, 9 to the log base 9 of x, the exponential and the logarithm have the same base, so they wipe each other out, and I just get an x. I would like to do the same thing for the second piece, but they don't match. What I can do is I can rewrite the 9 as a 3 squared. And here's where we have to be very careful about where things go, because I have a lot of different levels, right? Here's a power, and then this is a power of that power, and inside that power I have logarithms, and inside that log I have something to a power, so you have to be very careful about where things are. Okay. I'm going to use a property of exponents. If I take an exponent raised to another exponent, I multiply them, so I can take that 2 and multiply it by log base 3 of x cubed. So we're going to have x times 3 to the power of 2 log base 3 of x cubed. And then I'm going to use another property over again, right, of logs, where I take this 2 and I move it up as an exponent. So I have my x cubed, and I'm going to raise it to the power of 2. So we're going to have x times 3 to the log base 3. X cubed squared will give me an x to the 6th. Okay, and now my exponential base 3 and my log base 3 will cancel, so I'm going to have x times x to the 6th. And now I'm just multiplying x's, so that'll be x to the 7th. And then to solve for x, I'm going to take the 7th root of both sides. So I have the 7th root of 9 to the 14th. Or I can think of the 7th root as being like a 1/7th power. So I have 9 to the power of 14 over 7, which is 9 squared, which is 81. So the answer to this whole thing is x equals 81. Okay, like I said, that one is terribly complicated, and it's not that I'm going to expect you to do this going forward. What I want you to do, though, is just to really stretch all of your log rules and exponential rules all at once. Okay, number 12 is going to be similar, but I think number 12 is a little bit easier. And the thing that makes it easier is that we have the same base on all of them. Remember that natural log is just a base of e. Now, the thing that I want to be careful about is I can't just take e to each piece individually and end up with x plus x minus 2 equals x plus 4. Okay, because what we're doing is we're taking e to the power of both sides, and on the left-hand side I have an addition. So rather than start by taking e to the power of both sides, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get rid of this addition by combining these together. Okay, so if I combine these, I'm adding logs, so I'm going to get log of x times x minus 2. Okay, and now we can take e to the both sides because there's just one thing on each side, and the e's and the natural logs wipe each other out. And what I'm left with, x times x minus 2 equals x plus 4, is going to give me a quadratic. So I'm going to start by distributing the x. So we have x squared minus 2x equals x plus 4. Subtract x on both sides. Subtract 4 on both sides. So we have x squared minus 3x minus 4 equals 0. And I did the quadratic formula earlier, but this one, it doesn't have a, it's a coefficient of 1 on the x squared. I think this one's going to be a little bit easier. We'll go ahead and factor it. So x minus 4 times x plus 1 equals 0. When I have two multiplied factors equal to 0, I can set each one equal to 0 separately. So I get x equals 4 or x equals negative 1. One of the things I need to be very careful about when I'm solving complicated algebra equations, and in particular when I solve a quadratic and I get more than one answer, we need to make sure that these answers make sense. And I don't mean that you have to like plug it in and compute the number out. That's not a bad idea. But we need to make sure that they at least make sense when I plug them in. So if I put in 4, I'd have natural log of 4 plus natural log of 4 minus 2, which is natural log of 2. That's at equal to the natural log of 4 plus 4, or 8. Okay. If I put in a negative 1, natural log of negative 1 doesn't make sense. We can't take logs of negatives. So this isn't a real answer. That's, if I were to try to plug in x equals negative 1 into my original equation, I would get something that's not a number. Okay. So I only have one solution here, x equals 4. Okay, we have the last two problems. Our last two problems on the review are about finding inverses. The idea behind a function and an inverse is that the inputs and the outputs switch. So if I think of y is my function f of x, I write y equals the function 6x plus 2 over 9 minus 4x. Then, when we find the inverse, with the inverse, the roles of input and output switch. So if I think of my x as my input and y as my output, for the inverse function, they should swap roles. So what we do is we switch the x's and y's. So then I would have x equals 6y plus 2 over 9 minus 4y. And now I just want to find, the y equals equation, so now solve for y. Okay. So what I'm going to do is, I don't want the y in the denominator here. I'm going to start by multiplying both sides by 9 minus 4y. Okay. So that's being multiplied by x. So I have 9x minus 4xy equals 6y plus 2, right? The fraction canceled on the right-hand side. We don't have a fraction anymore. Since I'm solving for y, I want to gather all of the y's together. So I'm going to subtract 6y from both sides. And when I gather the y's together, stuff that doesn't have a y in it, I want to get rid of. So I'm going to subtract 9x from both sides. So I have negative 6y minus 4xy equals, here the 6y minus 6y canceled. So now I have just the negative 9x plus 2. Now everything on the left has a y in it, so we can factor out the y. So I'm going to have y times negative 6 minus 4x on the left, negative 9x plus 2 on the right. So then our last step will be divide to get y by itself. So y equals negative 9x plus 2 over negative 6 minus 4x. Okay. And that's my inverse function. All right. Working with inverses is important. Being able to solve inverses like this isn't the most important thing that we'll be working on. And when you go through this section, when we review it, this process isn't going to be terribly important. This algebra technique of solving for y by getting all the y's on one side and factoring it out, we will use that later in this course for something totally unrelated to inverse functions. So that's not a bad thing to have gone over, and that's why I've included this in here. Okay, but as far as computing inverse functions like this, we're not going to be doing a whole lot of that. So I think I'm going to skip problem 14 here. We have it on there, but I don't think we need to go through that. What we want to do is understand the process behind it. We want to understand when I solve for an inverse function, I can maybe remember the technique is to switch x and y and solve for y, but it's more important to remember why. And it's because with functions and inverses, the inputs and outputs switch. And, you know, when I look at a graph, you know, if I swap the x's and y's, I'll go from the graph of one to the graph of another, right? And that's the type of thing that we want to keep in mind going forward when we're looking at inverses and we're working with inverses. Okay. I think that's enough of this review worksheet. So I'm going to go ahead and post this to Blackboard. The idea for this first couple of weeks, we're going to treat this a little bit like an online class. So you have the stuff to look through, right? You go one section at a time, watch the videos, do the homework. The homework is all due on a Monday. You know, and as I mentioned before, the idea is to get your homework done during the week. Maybe you finish up over the weekend. What we'll do is reserve some time on Monday in class for going over homework problems. And that way, after class, you can go back and any homework problems that you couldn't get, you can fix and get 100% on your homeworks. You don't have to wait till Monday to do that, but it gives us a little bit of an opportunity. And when we get back to in class, you know, we'll take advantage of that for going over questions in class. Going forward, starting with week 3 when we're back in person, our weeks are going to be split up a little bit differently. There are going to be some things that I'm going to say, do this before class on Monday, and other things that I'm going to say, do this before class on Wednesday. So it's not going to be broken. It's going to be broken down more than just by week, right? Because there are some things that we want to have done before we start our class sessions so that we're all on the same page, right? That way we're all at the same readiness level. We've all gone through certain material. And then we can dive right into problems and answer questions, and everybody's looked at the stuff, okay? But for right now, we're going to treat things a whole week at a time. So I just want you to be aware, the first 2 weeks, it's a whole week at a time, but starting with week 3, it's not going to be quite a whole week at a time. It's going to be subdivided a little bit further than that. All right, any questions? If you do have some questions and you didn't get them answered yet, or you know, something, you know, can feel free to stick around, or send me an email if they come up later. But otherwise, I think that's it for our first day of class. So, you know, enjoy the weekend. Good luck getting all your homework done. And again, feel free to email me if you have any questions as you go, or we can set up a meeting to go through some material in more detail. Otherwise, I will see you next week.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.